We're going to make this as conversational as possible before we move into our final celebration, which is planned by students here at the Divinity School, including a graduate, Andy Barnett. And if you all take a seat, we can conclude with, so what does living cosmology look like from some of the different perspectives of the Christian traditions, in plural? As it was said this morning, there's not one Christian tradition, there's many. So here's the game plan. Each person is going to speak for 5 minutes, and then they're going to interact a little bit with each other, four on one side, and then four on the other. So it's conversational, and then we'll have the same bouquet of questions from people, questions and comments from the audience, okay? They've done wonderful papers, and again, we'll make all this available right after the conference. So here we go. We're going to begin to my left with Dennis O'Hara speaking on the Catholic tradition, Steve Blackmer speaking on the Episcopal tradition, Barbara Rossing on Lutheranism, and Beth Norcross speaking from the Wesleyan tradition. So we're going to start over here and brief 5 minute summaries of some marvelous papers and then some interaction.
Good afternoon. So I'm going to focus on one aspect of my paper, and that's the notion of human ecology. Recently, there's a great deal of excitement in the Roman Catholic tradition about this forthcoming eco-encyclical, as we're hoping it will be from Pope Francis. And also at the same time we hear that news, we hear the comments that it will focus on on human ecology, and for some of us that makes us a bit nervous. And the reason is this, that John Paul II and Benedict have also spoken about human ecology, but when they speak about it, it's in a way that I think is not in harmony with Journey of the Universe. So what I want to do is talk about the problematic dimensions of human ecology, and the way that I think Journey of the Universe can help us, and then also why I think we should be a little bit reservedly hopeful about what Francis can do. So to begin with, the Catholic popes since 1950 have said that there's no problem with Roman Catholics accepting evolution. It doesn't contradict anything in our tradition. Yes, we know that the Earth isn't the center of the universe, but I would say what they don't add is that we will just continue to think as if it is the center of the universe. So Journey of the Universe could help that. So that's number one. Secondly, when they talk about human ecology, they always see it as superior or more important than any sense of earth ecology. So they will still talk in very anthropocentric language, and it is still the sense that the earth is there to support the flourishing of the human. I would say that Journey of the Universe would say that human ecology is derivative, whereas earth ecology is primary. If we were to think about the humans come into the universe story very late, and therefore are they dependent upon those players in the story who came before them that created the conditions that make it possible to have humans. Therefore, humans are actually more dependent and therefore more vulnerable and therefore not the top of the pyramid. Also, the Journey of the Universe helps us to understand consciousness in a much greater way, in a way that I think would be anathema to John Paul and Benedict. So the sense that the universe is a communion of subjects, not a collection of objects, a sense that the universe has had a psychic spiritual dimension from its beginning, not just the physical material. This understanding of consciousness would help to inform a much better understanding of human ecology. Thirdly, when both Benedict and John Paul would talk about stewardship, Journey of the Universe reminds us that this is a self-organizing, self-regulating, self-problem-solving universe that did extremely well prior to humans coming into existence. It does not need us, and nor do we have the wisdom and understanding to be stewards, to be managers of the universe. If anything, it just simply needs us to get out of the way. Finally, let me just speak a little bit about Francis, who I like a lot. There are reasons to be hopeful that he will write about human ecology differently. He has sought out the work of Leonardo Boff to inform what he is writing, but he has also written some wonderful things. We all know that he says these things about being more focused on the suffering of the earth as well as the suffering of people. He connects economy and ecology much more and in a much more holistic way. But listen to this sentence from his encyclical or his apostolic exhortation, Evangelii Gaudium, if I can find it here, yes. Thanks to our bodies, God has joined us so closely to the world around us that we can feel the desertification of the soil almost as a physical ailment, and the extinction of a species as a painful disfigurement. Now, this is a man who I hope will be talking about solidarity in a way that isn't just human solidarity or solidarity with the poor or preferential option for the poor, but a poor in the sense of a much greater understanding. So I am hopeful that his writings around human ecology will be more in tune with Journey of the Universe, but I am almost also mindful, especially after the last synod, that some of his views are not always well received, and he will have to take a step rather than give us a full journey in this next encyclical.
Thank you. Perfect. Thank you, Steve.
Go. I'm Steve Blackmer, chaplain of Church of the Woods in Canterbury, New Hampshire. To begin, I want to summarize the entire Christian tradition. The world was created good. People screwed it up. People can be transformed and the world may be healed. Right? I mean, isn't that pretty much the essence of it?
Yeah.
It's a good story. It's a good story. I'm a recent convert to Christianity in the last 6 years, having come from a career as an environmental activist. The mystery of that is beyond reckoning. But in my effort to try and understand why I am now a Christian and a priest in the Episcopal Church, I've spent a great deal of time, not least in this institution, staring out the windows. So I want to pause just for a moment and have everybody look out the window at a tree. Yeah, the ones to the south are blocked, so you might have to reach because the sun shines in. Anyway, look out and just marvel for a second. The whole time I was here in seminary, the whole time I was in the discernment process, I was wondering, how can there be a church that is actually outdoors? So when I graduated, bishops, we were talking earlier, bishops matter. Thank be to God for the bishops of the Episcopal Diocese of New Hampshire. I am now the chaplain of a Church of the Woods, which is, in fact, entirely outdoors, and the congregation is meeting at this very hour while I am here. We have 106 acres of wild, logged over recovering land in Canterbury, New Hampshire. You're all invited to come and see that we meet outdoors. Come winter, I hope this winter, maybe next winter, we'll have a little cabin, a little chapel to keep us warm in a January snowy day. But even then, going back to the previous panel, in place of a spoken human homily, there is an earth homily. Of 30 to 40 minutes of silence, each person being outside, simply to drink it in, and then a Eucharistic celebration from that, bringing gifts from the woods to place on the altar, which is currently a tree stump, tree having been sacrificed, And we celebrate there the first morsel of bread is given back to the earth. The first drops of wine are given back to the earth is a reflection of where we get those gifts, and then in turn we offer ourselves. So it's a deeply Christian practice in a setting that's very unfamiliar to the church. I would dearly love other people to pick up this idea and carry it forward into the world. And in big part, that's why I'm here, is to say, I want more churches of the woods, or churches of the prairies, or churches of the river, or churches of this and that, to get people outdoors. I deeply believe that there is no salvation for the earth without going outside. It just ain't gonna happen, folks. And yes, we do need nice spaces. I want to talk just for a minute about a project we did, our very first project, because we're just getting started in this, that we did in June, an expression of Holy Week.
1 minute, Steve.
1 minute. It was a 4-day event we did in partnership with St. James Episcopal Church in Vermont. And I want to read you just a little bit of the Good Friday liturgy that we used. New Zealand storm petrel, Dutch Alcon blue butterfly, golden toad, Zanzibar leopard, Madeiran large white butterfly, Tekupa pupfish, Pyrenean ibex, little blue macaw, round island burrowing boa constrictor. This was a part of the litany of the extinct. It broke hearts open. It broke hearts open. Much of it was chanted back and forth between English and Latin. It was an extraordinarily beautiful and heartbreaking event as these species were crucified. So again, I'm looking for partners who are interested in taking these ideas, spreading them out. And Jason, I have been thinking about a religious community, creating a far-flung, non-monastic, non-residential community. So I'd love to talk with others about that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Steve. Barbara Rossing.
Well, Lutherans certainly are very similar to Roman Catholics and Episcopalians. The one thing we've got going for us in this moment is the 500th anniversary of the Reformation coming up, as Larry Rasmussen mentioned. So I'm going to entitle this Lenses on a Living Cosmology and a Lutheran Call for a New Eco-Justice Reformation. Lutherans can and do embrace evolutionary cosmology. We're proud of the fact that in the 2005 Dover, Pennsylvania court decision ruling against intelligent design being allowed to be taught in the schools of science, because it's actually creationism, the judge was a Lutheran and a conservative Lutheran Republican. So Lutherans do not have a big problem with evolution. I grew up in a family of scientists. At the seminary where I teach, we have the Zygon Center for Religion and Science. We co-teach with scientists. We hope that all our students go out embracing evolutionary cosmology and the importance of religion and science. It's a harder sell with global warming and climate change, I would say. We have many Lutherans living in North Dakota, the center of the Bakken oil fields, many Lutherans also in Pennsylvania, the Marcellus Shale and fracking. And this is a contested issue, although I should say that one of the rock stars of Lutheranism right now is Archbishop Antje Jacqueline of the Church of Sweden, the largest Lutheran church in the world, and she's made climate change her big issue. So Lutherans love the Reformation, and we can't help but notice that it was almost 500 years ago in 1517 that Martin Luther nailed his 95 theses to the Wittenberg Castle church door, if he did. I mean, this might be apocryphal. But the question is... Yeah, if he did, it wasn't. So the question is, as we approach this 500th anniversary, what does it mean? Do we celebrate it as what needs reforming now, or do we kind of look back? Fortunately, we no longer are in polemics with Roman Catholics. In fact, there's a wonderful new document from the Pontifical Council for Promoting Christian Unity and the Lutheran World Federation on a joint way to tell the story of the Reformation. But do we just, you know, sit around and go on trips to Germany or what? Larry Rasmus and I are both signers on a very recent open letter to our presiding bishop and all the bishops, arguing that this Reformation anniversary comes at a kairos moment for the creation, and this needs to be an occasion for an eco-reformation in Lutheran churches. So that issue needs to be at the center of our Reformation commemorations, and we'll see what happens. We haven't gotten any responses, but stay tuned. The Lutheran conviction that God is in all things and the goodness of creation was one that actually you see in Luther's polemics against the Reformed, the Calvinists, when Luther insists that the finite can hold the infinite. So Larry Rasmussen, who's been such a leader in this, calls it joyous panentheism, the idea that God is in all things. Danish Lutheran Niels Gregersen calls it deep incarnation. But this treasure we have, that God really is in the material world, I think is one of the most important things that we need to draw on. And to be sure, our theology needs reforming to get to this point. I mean, we still teach in Sunday school, or at least I learned, you know, that salvation is about going to heaven after you die, leaving earth. It's the danger is a kind of heavenism, as Norman Hobble calls it. So we need to work on this. Another resource of the Lutheran tradition is what I would call our sort of Thomas Berry, Joseph Sittler. I don't know. I mean, he didn't have the same range as Thomas Berry, but already in 1961 at the World Council of Churches Assembly in New Delhi, he argued that God and Christ came to reconcile all things, ta panta, as the Epistle to Colossians says, and that this idea of the reconciliation of all things is much bigger than human salvation. It's a Christology of nature, he argued. Lutheran theology, the cross is also really important, that God is to be found most of all in brokenness and pain. And I think this notion can help us face the structural sin that is climate change and the devastation that hits the poorest of the poor most severely. It's an analysis is done by global Lutheran scholars, a Dalit theologian, Monica Melanchthon, an Argentinian, Guillermo Hansen, I draw on his work a lot, my colleague Vitor Vestella from Brazil, and certainly indigenous voices, George Tinker from the Native American tradition in the United States. So I'll just make that case that we in Lutheranism are trying to argue that we need an ecological reformation that fundamentally challenges imperial cosmologies and imperial economics. Luther actually was a pretty good critic of the nascent capitalist economic system. His treatises on usury, for example, are fascinating, and he's got a pretty hard-hitting economic critique that I think we can draw on at a time when extractive capitalism is itself functioning as a religion in our culture. And Luther's critique of mammon is also pretty radical, where he says that the basic idolatry that we all have is worshiping mammon, and I think there's a lot of economic teachings coming out of the Reformation that we can draw on. So let me just say that I think the message we all need is a message of hope, and this is the way we're trying to position this Reformation commemoration. Okay, I'm out of time.
That's great. Thank you.
That was great.
These are hors d'oeuvres, but they're fabulous. They're very yummy.
With apology to Larry Rasmussen, when a Methodist puts her watch on the table, it actually means something. So I feel somewhat constrained as our time has gone from 12 to 10 to 8 to 5, so I will speak quickly. My paper outlines our earth ethic that the Methodists do hold very dearly, and I think we don't need to say anything more about that. I want to speak directly to the role of journey and how it can help that ethic become a reality. The policies and processes within the Methodist Church, I think, are in place, but we need a new story. There's not a lot that Methodists agree on. I feel a little uncomfortable up here speaking for all Methodism and being constrained by that Methodist clock to boot. But one of the things that we do talk a lot about in Methodist seminaries is the Wesley quadrilateral, which is interesting because it's neither a quadrilateral or particularly Wesleyan, but we do hold it dear. And these are our are four ways, four means to getting to God, to developing relationship with God, and for understanding God. And they are scripture, reason, experience, and church tradition. Now, Methodism, not particularly this Methodist, but Methodism holds scripture up as the primary revelation. And so I think it's here that the journey can help, because I see scripture as a story, as our sacred stories. And it's in this place that journey can help revitalize that story. By way of example, just one of our stories, that first creation story that was created in the 6th century BCE, you're familiar with it. Those, that very orderly 6 days of creation. We have that very troubling dominion passage in there and that imaging passage that's caused us all sorts of trouble. But that story has a particular context. It was written and developed for a particular people at a particular time. As Barbara Rossing said earlier, the Israelites had been taken into bondage. They were enslaved. They were subjugated. This was a reassurance that the human mattered in the midst of this enslavement. What do we do now when we are the enslavers, when we are the subjugators, we are the oppressors? We are no longer in bondage. And that's where journey can be so very helpful to us. Joseph Campbell and others have been critical of Christianity, in particular because it refuses to update its myths, its mythologies. I don't know that the journey can replace that mythology, that sacred story, but I think it can infuse new life in a couple of key ways. I just wanted to land on a couple. One is this notion that's at the heart of the universe story, and that's transformation. At atomic level, at the cellular level, at the molecular level, the organism level, the universe expands and grows because it's transformed at every level. What does journey have to tell us about the transformation that's necessary if we are going to do this work? And then the second thing I would like to lift up is the work of Steve and others who are trying to re-sacralize nature. I think it was there to begin with, but we need to have that reemerge. So this story, this old creation story of a particular time, journey helps us particularize a new story. I would challenge us in one particular way, one problem, one challenge that Methodists are going to have with the journey is what one might call the God problem. We've talked around it a little bit, but I'd like to name it quite directly. Is there God in the universe story? I see it there. There's the creator. There's imagination. There's immanence. There's transcendence. This Methodist might call that God. But other Methodists in the pews, that might be a stretch for them. And so we have to have that conversation about what God looks like in the context of this new story. I see the creator God. It's a little bit harder for me to see a personal God, the comforter God that comes on a very personal and individual basis. Does that mean we shouldn't engage journey? No. It's a wonderful, fresh, new way of putting putting some new wine in some old wineskins and making it breathe life. So I think I'll just stop there.
Thank you so much. So the game plan, I feel like this is a talk show or something, but the game plan is for them to interact along with their conversation partners. So just for a few minutes, questions that might arise from anyone up here.
I just want to respond and say, of course, Christianity began outdoors. And Methodism began outdoors. So there is much to draw on there. You are leading us back to the future.
I just want to underscore this point about the personal. I think that's really key, and I think the making that link from the cosmological to the personal is—it's a very challenging thing. I'm sure many of you have seen Terrence Malick's film *The Tree of Life*, which I think is an attempt to sort of stretch the imagination to the cosmological level at the same time as contextualizing the personal in that way and addressing theological tough issues. Because I think suffering and loss and death are crucial to how we think about the cosmos. And if we can't find room for God in that story, then I think it gets very difficult for people.
Anything else?
Go ahead.
Okay, no, you go. Sure.
Look, I'm Canadian, you have to do it.
So polite.
He stumped me on that. Beth, I wondered if you wanted to say a word about your Center for Spirituality in Nature.
Briefly. Thank you for that plug. I do teach at Wesley Seminary as adjunct, but one of the things that was emerging continually in the teaching was this notion of the outdoors, of the natural world, as a place to experience and understand God, to understand our spirituality, but also understand our place. And so we began a new venture called the Center for Spirituality and Nature, which attempts to bring people, much like Steve does, outside into the natural world, develop spiritual practices that open us up to nature and to God outdoors. So thank you, Steve, for an opportunity to say something about that.
Dennis?
I was just going to mention that in response to the where is God in the for instance, the journey of the universe or the universe story, not God as the personal image that we often hold, but the divinity that is within that story. And I especially like the work that's being done in deep incarnation or in ecological pneumatology that get us past the more Christological notions, the person of Christ notions of the divine in creation, where we no longer hold on to the incarnation as just a historical event of a certain, 30 some odd years, but an event that emerges out of an incarnation that was already present within creation that manifests in a particular person at a particular time. It's sometimes controversial work, but I find it very exciting because it helps us to see the cosmological story as a divine story in a way that we haven't done before. And I think these are areas that will be fruitful for us to continue to explore.
This was Teilhard's big question, too.
Yes.
A cosmic Christ of the universe, the personal dimension. I just want to say, after showing Journey up at University of Toronto with our Canadian friends, the first question often is, where's God here? And I said, this is a divine milieu. It's everywhere, you see. I mean, that's the point. That's the point of this conference. And we just had all these papers speaking about the divine milieu. That's what we're trying to draw forth from the theologians and ethicists. John says I can't talk.
Yes.
I think there's a point here about the personal, just in terms of, say, bhakti, devotion.
Yes.
Deep devotion. That's slightly different than the divine.
Yeah, that's true.
Not to be right.
Thank you. He corrected me. I stand corrected.
Barbara, I wondered if you'd say a word more about the cross and climate change. Because I think that's really important, the idea that in climate change, in the disaster, in the suffering, we can encounter God. That matters.
Well, it's so terrible that I was part of a Lutheran World Federation project where we tried to do a theology for climate change, and we interviewed people in Africa and Asia and other places up in the Arctic, and it was a question, what's changing about your climate? What are you experiencing, and where do you find God in this? And the overwhelming response people had was, why is God punishing us? So I think it's really important to take that theology, which, you can find in little places in the Bible, but it's by far not the dominant narrative of why disaster happens to people, and you have to rather shift it to say that God is with us in all the suffering, and God does not inflict this. It's not a punishment. But, of course, it's experienced that way because the people that did nothing to cause it are those who are experiencing the terrible cross of climate change. I mean, there's various ways you can work theology of the cross. since I work on the Book of Revelation, I like to do cross to sort of tree of life, the idea that even out of the worst of our suffering and injustice and torture, even of the earth, I mean, that that there's the possibility of the tree of life. And that's certainly, you find it in medieval art, you know, the San Clemente Church in Rome and stuff. But how to do a theology of the cross and climate change. The other problem is, of course, the delay, so that what we're, our sin now is causing grievous ill to future generations. And to those who we heard in the jurisprudence session don't even have a voice. So Larry, actually, I learned this from you, and you got it from Henrik Grappa in Sweden, right? When you do talks, you do the three empty chairs to signify that also deserving to have a voice in our deliberations are the poor, who often aren't represented, and future generations, and all the other species and other kind of the earth. I mean, they all need to be considered, and they're the ones bearing the cross today.
Thank you. Any other final comments?
Or I will say to Steve that if I'd met you when I was younger, I might have stayed an Episcopalian.
That's great. So I think we're ready to turn to this side, and George Handley from Brigham Young University, doing amazing work with the Mormons. We're so happy you're here.
Thank you. I've written my comments because I've been thinking so much over the last 24 hours that I had more things to say here than I did in my paper. I want to say that I'm grateful to be part of a group that includes a Christian response to Journey of the Universe as a Mormon, because as many of you may know, not all Christians agree that we should be defined as Christians, even though we vehemently self-identify as Christians. So it's nice to be in this wonderful group. And some of the reasons for that exclusion are doctrinal, right? And I think Catherine Keller made a very nice appeal for why we can't afford any longer to engage in those kinds of squabbles. So I'm very grateful for the spirit here in that regard. And perhaps in this audience, the revelations of Joseph Smith, which Mormons take to be a restoration of primitive Christianity, will not seem quite so heretical or disturbing, and might in fact be appreciated for their particular suitability for understanding and accepting the story of the universe. Indeed, much of what Journey of the Universe teaches, I have seen firsthand with my students at Brigham Young University, which is owned by the LDS Church, that they respond very, very well to the story. In the years 1830 and 1831, Joseph Smith undertook what Mormons consider to be an inspired translation of the Bible, which was an attempt to recover truths that were presumed to have been lost in translation over the generations. And if poetry is what is lost in translation, as Robert Frost once said, we might think of Joseph Smith's work as a theopoetics. And it might not be an entirely new story, as Thomas Berry called for, but it's certainly a version of what Lynn White felt was needed, either a new religion or at least a rethinking of an old one that brought the cosmos back into Genesis, as you'll see. And in a book known as the Book of Moses, we read an account of Moses receiving the vision of the creation that presumably led to the story in Genesis. And he sees the earth and all of its inhabitants, and is overwhelmed by the grandeur of what he sees, and he collapses, and this is what he says: "For this cause I know that man is nothing, which thing I never had supposed." Overcome and decentered and disoriented in this way, he's rather vulnerable to satanic temptation. So Satan appears and tempts him in this moment of disorientation to regroup and redefine himself by means of the power and material possessions he might gain from the earth itself. But Moses resists. He says that he is God's son, that he is loved, and therefore he doesn't feel tempted. I see this as his unique and even exceptional human opportunity to experience this awe, not to possess or control or to know the world. I would say here that Moses is more homo admirans, as William Brown so wonderfully put it in Seven Pillars of Creation, which hasn't been mentioned this weekend and I think is a fantastic book, but as opposed to homo sapiens, right?
Moses' reward for this humility is that God then gives him a window into his other creations, and I'll read here. "And worlds without number have I created, and I also created them for mine own purpose, and there are many worlds that have passed away by the word of my power. The heavens, they are many, and they cannot be numbered unto man, but they are numbered unto me, for they are mine." Again, an 1830 revelation, heretical at the time, but certainly prescient, given what science, of course, is telling us about the immensity of the universe. But there's far more to this new story that Joseph Smith told. We learn that the world was created out of unorganized matter, not out of nothing. And when I read Catherine Keller's The Face of the Deep, I was stunned at how, in this odd way, Mormon it felt. God partners with chaos rather than vanquishes it to make life possible. We learn, too, that we were with God as his spirit children before the creation of the world and even participated in the creation, which I think is quite radical in its implications. We learn that even before we were born spiritually, we were what are known as intelligences. That is, like the physical matter of the creation itself, our capacity of judgment and agency could neither be created nor destroyed. Now, this, of course, has implications about God's omniscience. We learn, too, that the world was created spiritually before it was created physically, that all plants, animals, and human beings alike are described as living souls, which, of course, brings the soul back into animal, inherently good and spiritually present. Now, I feel like I won the doctrinal lottery as an environmentalist when I read this stuff, and I admit that it's rich and it resonates well with the creation story and journey of the universe, and it has inspired many Mormons to embrace science and stewardship. But if theology is as influential and important as this conference supposes it is, I think it's important to ask why such inspirations are not more common among Mormons or perhaps other Christians. I hope you won't judge Mormons by the voting records of Utah politics. Because I've spent a lot of my time trying to uncover the more rich and important heritages of Mormons than is evident by such a record. But there's no getting around the problem that pundits on Fox News seem to have more influence on a lot of Mormons than the implications of their own theology. And this is one of the great tragedies. I don't know all of the answers about why this is the case, but I think I will just leave one quick thought about this. The journey of the universe is a story rife with violence, chance, chaos, and tragedy. And there's no reason to mince words about this. I think it's far easier to despair at this story than I think we have been admitting at this conference. Or as is more often the case, it is easier to deny it or to repress our resentment for nature's constant reminders of our own death. We are tempted by simpler theologies as a result, right? And one of those theologies might be make yourself rich and define your own autonomy, as Satan says to Moses, or it could be something like Ayn Randian self-determination or a theologically infused self-help that is always underwritten by divine power. So when we get something or lose something, it's always God. We do not like to acknowledge that accidents and injustice happen in a universe such as this one. But central then, I think, to the meaning of Christ's suffering, which I think is the theology of the cross, is his compassion not just for the sorrows of sin, but the sorrows of physical existence and our struggles with mortality and with biology itself. Christ weeps with us, not just for us, and he weeps for and with the earth. And this is the most central purpose of his embodiment. Moses' experience of awe does not become despair, even though I think he might have been tempted, but instead inspires reverent care because he remembers God's love. And I believe God's love is the contact with the imperishable that John Haught was referring to yesterday. And I don't know, I'm a naive enough newbie in theology that I don't know if it's okay to quote a process theologian and a systematic theologian in the same presentation. But they're both heroes of mine, so that's what the way it is. I think love, God's love, is the hope with which we can confront the changing, complex, sometimes tragic, and estranging facts of our physical existence.
Thank you very much. And George's work with the Mormon tradition and with Terry Tempest Williams and others is quite a story, and I hope he'll tell it one day. Absolutely marvelous. Please continue, along with Jason Brown back there. Russ Powell, a student here at YDS, now at Princeton Theological Seminary, working on his PhD, and we're delighted to have you speak about your tradition.
Thank you. I'm representing the Presbyterians, and please forgive my needing to have my computer out, cutting a 10-page paper down to a 2-page paper to hit my 5-minute mark. I want to make sure I hit all the high points. So among the many ways I could explore the interesting intersections between Presbyterianism with its attendant commitment to the Reformed theological tradition and Journey of the Universe, what I've chosen to look at is wonder, something that we've talked about a lot this weekend. So what's wonder? Tucker and Swim in the Journey book tell us wonder is, quote, a gateway through which the universe floods in and takes residence in us, end quote. In it, they go on to say, we participate in the primal energies of nature's majesty. We come to understand the manifold ways we're awakened and permeated by the universe. Yet the thing I find most interesting about wonder, at least in Journey's understanding of the term, is the way Tucker and Swim tell us it guides us. This, despite how chilly it was on that boat at the conclusion of the film, as you said yesterday, Mary Evelyn. So by wonder guiding us, I take Tucker and Swim to mean that wonder possesses the power to influence and shape our lives, especially insofar as it affects our behavior. Feeling wonder at the universe, in other words, calibrates our practical agency, not only in how we act and behave in the world, but in how we behave towards it, too. So here we should stop to ask, how does this happen exactly, right? So what are the details? We could no doubt offer myriad interesting answers to these questions, but the Reformed tradition, Presbyterianism, offers an evocative one that I'll briefly consider this afternoon. So John Calvin, the French theologian and progenitor of Reformed thought, fully recognized the force that wonder has upon the human religious experience. Nature, Calvin thought, was the proscenium arch of the world, not unlike the arch above us here in Mark I Chapel today. So, as such, nature is what frames our existence. It's the place where God's all-encompassing providence is enacted and discerned. But it wasn't until the 18th century German romantic theologian Friedrich Schleiermacher came along that Calvin's understanding of nature and its potential resonance with a film and book like Journey fully flowered. So Schleiermacher followed Calvin in affirming God's presence in the world, but importantly, he also refused to differentiate between the realms of freedom and necessity in his theology. So that is to say, Schleiermacher bucked the Enlightenment penchant for alienating human beings from nature, or disenchanting our sense of connectedness to the external world. Schleiermacher instead saw nature not from the putatively objective standpoint of modern science, which believed that value resided solely in the human mind and its imaginings, and thus not in the world itself. Rather, nature for Schleiermacher contains inherent properties and values that make normative demands upon us. Our experience of wonder, therefore, is not only part and parcel of what Schleiermacher described as religious experience, but wonder makes us engage with nature in more practical and not merely detached terms, right? So what's all this mean? Reformed thought, as I'm highlighting in the work of Schleiermacher here, sees the experience of wonder as a morally generative reaction to external value properties in the world. These properties necessarily make normative demands upon all our actions, from deeds of great consequence to the most trivial portions of our ethical conduct. In short, according to this strain of Reformed theology that I'm lifting up, when we experience wonder, we are under obligation to take the world and its innate value into account in any of our moral deliberations. So from this perspective, a Reformed perspective, the world is much more a place to live in, to be mindful of, and to finally care for than a place to simply master and control. So the world in the end is sacred and should be treated as such. Thank you.
Well, thank you. I think you've just done the rebuttal to Fred Simmons and Willis. That was
my old teacher, by the way.
I know. That's what this is all about, though. Really refreshing dialogue. How are we going to put this all in a book? These are so good.
Good luck.
Thank you. I know. It's incredible. Laurel Kearns, I just want to mention, has been a long-term colleague, along with Beth Norcross, on greening of seminaries. And there's a Green Seminary Initiative website that they've created and worked on for a long, long time. So anyone interested in that particular topic should connect with them, and they've been absolutely devoted to this work for a long time. From Drew University, for the Quaker tradition, Laurel Kearns.
When I first was assigned this task, I thought, oh, this is easy. Quakers love Thomas Berry, the story of the universe. I could go so many places and find folks interpreting it and bringing it into a tradition. And now, here at the end of the day, I think, oh, I really got it easy, because so many of you have already articulated the many ways that Quakers might understand our principal tenet. There is that of God in everyone. There is that of God in everything. But first, I want to start off with my deep, deep gratitude for the particular embodiments of the universe, the particular manifestations of God, present in Mary, Evelyn, and John, in Tara and Matt, and to all of you here, because I have spent these 2.5 days deeply held in the light with your presence here, and it is amazing. And I thank you for that source of energy. For Quaker understanding of there is that of God in everyone, we have revisited our four elders and come in our ecological consciousness, and our conviction is that is there of God in everything. George Fox, a key founder, sought, quote, unity with the creation. And a contemporary, Jacob Balthamly, pronounced, I see God in all creatures and every green thing. William Penn, the noted 17th century Quaker behind the founding of Pennsylvania, expressed a similar interpretation in his admonition to study nature, to study science. For how could man find the confidence to abuse it while they should see the great Creator stare them in the face in all and every part thereof? Out of this comes the radical command that we then must act in recognition of that relationship. We must seek, in the language of John Woolman, right relations. Quakerism is not a system of beliefs. Indeed, we could not ever agree on a belief system. It is a communal practice of listening, of everyday praxis, of relationality. And out of this comes our testimonies of simplicity, peace, equality, integrity, community. And my paper discusses a bit of how these are ecologically interpreted. For us, ethics, praxis cannot be separated. Thomas Berry has named this insight, this relationship, the mystical dimension of the universe. In his words, we can see that every being in the universe is cousin to every other being in the universe. Or in another place, as you have already heard, the universe is a communion of subjects. And this eloquently expresses the Quaker desire to recognize and respond to that of God in everything. A Quaker eco-bulletin issue devoted to the telling of the story of the universe puts it this way. Quote, since Earth itself and everything on it is an expression of this essentially unnameable yet pervasive fecundity of the universe, we can understand that of God as moving in all forms and creatures. The motion of creation is in every animal, every plant, every rock, every form and process of earth. In worship, we seek to find the inner light of the divine, to be open to that of God. And so I invite you into a moment of silence, into a moment of Quaker worship, short by Quaker standards and even shorter by the Universe Story standards, but a much-needed moment at the end of so many wonderful words. A minute to sense the presence here among us, to reflect on all you have heard. And in particular, what does this mean for you, for us, to walk a path that recognizes there is that of God in everything in the universe? In recognizing a community of subjects, how do we then live? My time is short. I apologize for breaking the silence. In the Universe Story, in this great work, and in this presence here among us, Quakers recognize their mystical insights, their testimonies as principles of living, their centuries-long commitment to understanding the world through science. As the book Journey aptly states in its beginning, every time we are drawn to look up into the night sky and reflect on the awesome beauty of the universe, we are actually the universe reflecting on itself. And this changes everything. As a child of the space age in Florida, it was the image of the Earth, that fragile oasis, as astronauts have commented, that for me and many others changed everything. And so I want to end with the ending part of a poem called Epiphany by Angela Mano, featured on the Quaker Earth Witness website. It takes the view of the astronauts who enabled us to see ourselves, for us not only to look up into the night sky, but to be able to look back at the place in the universe that we call home. And here she, I must think, have I some special right to gaze upon such beauty, the living host of all we know, all of history and music and poetry and art and birth and death and love and tears? What have I done to merit this moment, this glimpse of divinity, devastating beauty, mother of us all? Though I float miles above, I am a part of that life tied to her through her breath. I am afloat in the infinite sea. My heart races. There is no up or down, but there is worship. There is the bursting of my heart. There is the cry from the most profound depths. See where you live, humanity. See your own self. This tiny, miraculous island of life adrift in the vast cosmos. We are so alone, so fragile. there is nothing more glorious. And so said the saint, quote, because the divine could not image itself forth in any one being, it created the great diversity of things, so that what was lacking in one would be supplied by the others, and the whole universe together would participate in and manifest the divine more than any single thing. And the writer of Hindu texts says, I am beauty among beautiful things. For all eternity there is but one earth. I will tell them, I will make them understand, plunging back into you in a ball of fire. I will not forget your face. I will remember you, jewel of the universe, most holy ground, home.
Thank you, Laurel. And now Jim Antal from the UCC. We heard from him yesterday, and he's going to end this discussion and then some questions.
So during that wonderful opportunity for silence, we were asked, how shall we live? And it was wonderful to hear Gus Spaeth, or hear people talk about how Gus Spaeth lived when he was here and how he changed an institution. I want to bear testimony to my own personal answer to that question. And as I do, ask each of you, you're going to be changed by this time we have spent together. And if you're doing God's work, you're going to change others. Here's my version. I was called 8.5 years ago to my position to head the UCC in Massachusetts, and I said to my board of directors, I can't do this unless you do something for me, and that is allow me to spend 10% of my time doing climate work. Now, we have 370 churches and 820 pastors and 68,000 members. It's a lot to do there. And I asked for 10% of my time for climate work, and they did not bat an eye, and now I spend 20% of my time for climate work. Now, I'm redefining what it means to be a denominational leader in the Anthropocene. And each of you have to do that too. Whatever your calling is, you need to redefine what it is that calling is in the context of the Anthropocene. I wanted to share with you something that I say to pastors every time I gather with them, and it comes off of something that Barbara said when she made that comment about how people end up asking, why is God punishing us? I say to my pastors that they need to preach either every third or fourth sermon, at least touching upon, if not focusing on, climate change in one way or another, and they look at me like I have two heads, like I've forgotten everything that I learned when I was in school here. And I say, if we don't do that as spiritual leaders, then I don't know if it's 10 years, it won't be more than 15 years, every single sermon will be on grief. Grief for the world we let go, and the only use human beings will have for God is to go to God in our grief. So we have work to do, and I want to leave you with some headlines of hope, all of which have to do with something I refer to as changing the vocation of the church. Occasionally I use the phrase repurposing the church. That usually doesn't go over so well. So the first one is in honor of several of the papers that we've heard, particularly from the Dominican sisters. And that is, we need to end the ownership of nature. It's that simple. So the next time we gather, what I want to hear is how many houses of worship have put their land in trust. You all understand what I'm getting at? What would happen if the Vatican were to put its land in trust? So the laughter is interesting, right? Because no matter how you phrase it, you know, if I were a scientist, I could phrase it in a scientific way. I'm a religious guy, so I'm phrasing it in a religious way. It doesn't matter how you phrase it. getting from here to where we have to go that's going to allow continuity of existence, it's laughable how far we have to go. Believe me, putting our lands in trust in terms of all houses of worship, that's an easy task. Headline number two, Christians abandon material and economic growth as a measure of meaning and success. What if churches, synagogues, mosques, and temples accepted Thomas Berry's critique of material progress and instead, serving as laboratories of spiritual growth, they convicted society to measure progress in terms of equal distribution of recycled material resources and the increase in spiritual growth and happiness? And if you're thinking that this is some pie-in-the-sky fantasy, imagine if leaders of all faith perspectives had engaged in this campaign in the mid-1970s to the same extent that a very limited number of faith leaders initiated an anti-abortion campaign at that time. Look at the effect that had. Imagine the effect this could have. Headline number three. Christians now regard communal salvation on a par with personal salvation. What if Christians paid as much attention to those scriptures that emphasize communal salvation as they do to those passages that emphasize personal salvation? A theologian activist friend of mine puts it this way: did Jesus come with an evacuation plan or a building plan? Here's one way it might work. Imagine churches, synagogues, and mosques working together as advocacy centers for resilience and sustainable practices in their town. Let's use the bell in the church steeple for its original purpose, to sound the alarm and rally the town in response to an emergency. What we have going on today is a theological emergency. It's time for the sleeping giant of the church to awaken to the challenge.
2 minutes.
Headline number four. I'll do this. This is okay. It's going to work. Headline number four. Carbon tax passes due to lobbying efforts of churches. This could be the outcome of a campaign to expand the most basic moral instruction in both the New Testament and in Hebrew scriptures, a moral instruction at the core of every world religion. We are called to love our neighbors as ourselves, or on this good earth, we must recognize that future generations are no less our neighbors than those sitting next door to us in this room. I call this Golden Rule 2.0, and it's a straight line from that to a tax on carbon. Headline number five. Churches convince Supreme Court to change laws governing fiduciaries. The root word of the word fiduciary is faithful, being faithful to the future. The legal and investment world have teamed up as if they have exclusive rights to interpret society's understanding of fiduciary responsibility. It's both crazy and criminal to think that an investor has satisfied his or her fiduciary obligation by assuring maximum financial profit over the next quarter, while ignoring the fact that that investment will end up wrecking the home of the investor, our earth. Headline number six. I've only got two more. Is that okay? No? Okay, so I'm just going to give you the headlines. I won't give you the commentary. Headline number six, Supreme Court affirms doctrine of public trust. Nature can no longer be exploited for profit. Coalition of churches and children celebrate. Go to our childrenstrust.org. And the final headline, tens of thousands of churches launch truth and reconciliation commissions. When I spoke to our UCC churches in Texas, Louisiana, and Mississippi, it's hard to imagine UCC down there, but there are 90 of them. The pastor in Houston, this is it. She's giving me the eyeball. The pastor in Houston stood up in front of a group of pastors, and she said, ExxonMobil is building its world headquarters 2 miles from my congregation. In 2 years, 90% of my collection plate will be from ExxonMobil. Please comment. And I rocked back on my heels, and Desmond Tutu came to me. And I leaned forward and I said, you and I, we need to begin a movement that could spread to every church and must spread to every house of worship to initiate truth and reconciliation conversations on climate. That
okay,
would be
Jim,
real work that
Jim,
would redefine
that's it.
Church.
That's it. Thank you very, very much. I think there's no one here who would disagree with that, but we really want some conversation. So it's your turn over here. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, I've been waiting. I want to hear from George about Terry Tempest Williams and the story, because she's our environmental hero from the Mormon tradition, but I loved what you said about so many things. What's the story?
Well, I'm sure I have nowhere near enough time to answer that, but I would say maybe the latest chapter is that the LDS Church has issued a website about conservation and stewardship, and it is finding its way slowly into church curriculum, which is a big, big step in the right direction. And so there has not, and I've been at BYU for 16 years, and we've hosted conferences about stewardship, and we've got a climate change series coming up next semester that's a weekly event. We've got many outstanding climate scientists coming to campus, as well as highlighting climate science being, or climate related research being done on campus. Catherine Hayhoe is going to be coming next semester. So the educational and cultural shift is afoot, and I think it's not looking like it did 15 years ago, which is to say that there was a time when I first arrived in Utah. I was born in Utah and returned after my childhood in 1998, and back in the late 90s, early 2000s, it was tense. It was tension-filled to even do in educational initiatives, and it wasn't clear because it was seen as such a potentially polarizing political issue rather than a moral or ethical concern that shouldn't be partisan. So that's shifting. I mean, demographically, in terms of the politics, at least in the state of Utah, and maybe even nationally for Mormons, they still are predominantly Republican. But I think we've made inroads into helping mainstream folks who go to church every Sunday and are very active in the church feel like stewardship and concern for the earth is something that should matter to them. And from a cultural, I'm really involved in the cultural end of it, but I'm hoping that means some change in what kind of nonsense they're going to put up with when they hear this stuff on Fox News or from their own elected officials.
This has enormous implications for the whole West. Yeah. Any other questions over here for these folks?
Terry Tempest Williams.
Yeah. Terry.
Well, I haven't worked directly with her on these efforts, but as everyone knows, right? I mean, her voice has been so important to establishing an environmental ethic in the West, and she's done so rather publicly as a Mormon. Earlier in her career, I think a lot of mainstream Mormons kept their distance, and that was obviously very unfortunate because it meant that she wasn't going to be read. I mean, I tell students all the time, who's the most famous Mormon writer? Stephanie Meyer happens to be a Mormon, the author of Twilight series. So they might mention her first, but I say, no, it's Terry Tempest Williams, and she's one of our greatest treasures, and so we got to recognize that. But I think the bridges have been built back where she's no longer seen that way, and she's been on the BYU campus and been very, very affectionate and emotional and loving toward the university, as have the students and the faculty toward her. So I think it's a good thing.
Yeah, just to quickly follow up, at the University of Utah Law School about 2 years ago, there was a large meeting on environment, and one of the senior elders did a major statement that was put up on the Mormon website. But Terry, who's coming here this week actually and will be speaking on Wednesday and on Thursday at the Forestry School at 5:30, has been, as just to repeat really, but someone working within the tradition and yet also outside of it, like many of us.
I had a question for Russell. I was wondering, really, your eloquent statement, how does it manifest itself in the pews? When I was thinking about this assignment that Mary Evelyn gave us, I kept thinking about the people in the pews. And I wondered if you could say something about that.
Particularly for Presbyterian pews?
Those are the pews you're representing,
Those are
right?
the pews I'm representing. You know, when I get this species of question, especially from my master's students at Princeton Seminary, I tell them to go read John Calvin, who Thomas Berry sort of took as his foil to the new story, right? He's got this salvation mystique, and he's convinced us that we need to escape from the world. But if you read Calvin, you find that, you know, he goes so far as to say that the natural world is the mirror for the being of God. And further than that, he says that if it were not for human sin, that we could rightfully say that nature is God. John Calvin said that. You know, it's amazing. So how it manifests itself in the pews, I would like to see more of what Steve's doing in the Episcopalian Church, in the Presbyterian Church. I think getting in touch with the strain of resources inherent to the Reformed tradition that in so many ways has maybe led us astray on ecological issues, going outside and reconnecting with those resources inherent to the to what's going on in texts like Calvin. And Jonathan Edwards especially.
I think Marilyn Robinson would agree with you on your take on Calvin.
Absolutely, a committed Calvinist.
Anything else? So time for questions.
I wanted to say one thing.
Yeah.
I think that the radical call of recognizing there is that of God in everything and everyone opens us up to have to deal with the deep grief that is there. And if we don't deal with the grief, if we aren't open to that pain, then we have lost a lot of what will help us go forward. So it may seem odd to pair being open to grief and pain as the hope for how we go forward, but it is the nature of this work.
While they're moving around, Tara and Paul and Matt, will you just stand up over here, Tara and Paul and Matt? Let's give all of these folks a huge hand.
Tessa.
Up in the balcony are two people you probably can't see, but Rachel Mislivy and Elizabeth McAnally. Let's also thank them for filming and all kinds of things. Thank you. All right. Good.
Two things started me just being curious. It's when we raise the concept of God and then the person in the pew. Most of the traditions, with the exception of Quakerism, have a very anthropomorphic understanding of God. In the Catholic tradition, the official church won't even let us use non-male language for God. So God is not only male, God is obviously a person. And to what degree do we have to address that in order to evolve our consciousness to another understanding of the divine, in order to embrace the new cosmology? And to what degree can we do that with the people in the pew?
James and Imogene? Yeah. Okay.
Hi, thanks. What I'd like to point out to nobody in particular, but maybe you can all answer this in one way or another. I believe that that John's Gospel, the prologue to John's Gospel, actually gives us a cosmological vision that's very similar to perhaps what you're saying in the Journey book. And I haven't really heard that discussed this weekend at all. So I think when John tells us that without him was nothing made that was made, he's really giving us a vision of Christ in the entire cosmos. That everything that was made with, not only made with, but is supported by and is sustained by the love of Jesus Christ. And so I think that's a vision that we should try to hold up.
I mentioned that in the opening talks, John's Gospel. But okay. So let's make some more. There's lots of questions.
There's
short.
A question back here.
Okay.
Okay, James.
Well, yeah. All right.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
I have one other.
Finish your point. Finish your point.
Well, just because this is a talk about evolving Christianity, the other story that I would really look at is Eve's response to God when she's asked, you know, what did you do? She said, well, I was beguiled by the serpent. And I think if we began to look at ourselves as people who are confused and beguiled rather than fallen, that we have then an opening to look at the problems that we have in this world and view them as a perception, that our perception is what is wrong, not our state as being fallen.
Thank you. The spirit of all this is to try and be as brief as possible so they can answer everything. James Jenkins.
So this question comes very obviously from my position as a young person of faith and a wannabe activist. But two things I would love to hear more about are transforming all this rich and evolving faith into action and activism, and about creating opportunities for the next generation so that this movement can continue to grow and expand and propagate.
I want to ask, picking up on Larry's earlier notion of moving from a Protestant social justice to interfaith creation justice, there's such poignancy in your individual denominational experiences, and I think this relates to a communion of subjects, but how do you keep the intensity that you're offering doing ecumenical or interfaith communion around it?
My question is addressed to all the panelists. Has your denomination created and confirmed any binding language regarding the rights and responsibilities of your members, all your members, to eco-justice and cosmological spirituality? I ask this because 2 weeks ago, the Episcopal Diocese of Connecticut passed a resolution to change the baptismal covenant by the addition of a question, which reads, will you cherish the wondrous works of God and protect the beauty and integrity of all creation? The response is, I will, with God's help. This is clearly grounded in 21st century eco-justice and in the understanding of the interrelationships of all creation. It is also grounded in the concept of stewardship. Now, the process that this resolution will follow until it's adopted, hopefully by the National Church, will take approximately a decade. There will be votes, there will be testing and evaluation, but we sincerely hope that it will be adopted, and I wonder if any other denominations are doing something similar.
Anybody else? Imogene? Two more.
I want to say that as a visual artist, I've been stunned by and struggling with and in awe of the concept that we are all star stuff. So while you all were talking the last hour, I had this image, if we are all star stuff, then this whole experience has been a full flaring forth.
How can this urgency of extinction and climate justice call us to a great coming home as we simultaneously become a majority people of color nation?
Okay, one final one. Thank you.
This is just a final quote from Pythagoras. That's where we began. Be silent, or make what you say better than silence. I think that both of those conditions have been met this weekend. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, panelists, we're going to kind of jump around, and each one of you has a sort of a final moment. You can respond to whatever questions you want, but you know, keep it relatively brief. And so who wants to start? Yes, George.
Well, I've been pondering this question about the question about the identity of God or the personhood of God, I think, is related, goes back to Fred's discussion about whether or not cosmology determines or underdetermines ethics. I guess, in other words, how much does it matter whether or not we have a different wording or different language or vocabulary about God or about the baptismal covenant or other kinds of doctrinal notions? How much change will that affect in terms of the action and attitudes and maybe even voting habits of members of a particular faith? And I think I'm somewhat sympathetic to what Fred was getting at, because I think part of that's out of pragmatic necessity. I belong to a church where, I represent the youngest church, I think, here in this group, and it doesn't have the kind of democratization tradition that where at a state level, you know, a group of Mormons could change the language of a baptismal prayer or anything like that. So there's it's a revelatory church. So there's a sense of anticipation about what revelations might come forward. That's not to say that I think it's a good idea for Mormons or anybody else to sort of sit around and wait for somebody else to sort of tell you what to care about. That's what I keep telling my students and my fellow Mormons. But I do think it's important to recognize that in the urgency of climate change, the urgency for me inspires a need to be pragmatic within my tradition and say, well, I've got the language I've got. I've got the doctrines I've got. How can I use them? How can I read them? How can I tell the stories of the scriptures, as I tried to do very briefly here today, in a way that opens up new possibilities for people without ever having the opportunity, let alone the audacity, to try to change the doctrine or to change ordinances or whatever else might be important to religious practice in my community. So I think I'm by necessity, sort of in a pragmatic mode, where I'm less interested in arguing with my fellow Mormons or with other folks about which cosmology is the right one. I'm more interested, because I think that's a kind of arm wrestling that doesn't really get anywhere. I'm more interested in finding the common ground, the common understanding, and the values that might be motivational for someone who currently doesn't care much about climate change, for example. And I've written an essay that is a letter to a student. It was published in International Interdisciplinary Study of Literature and the Environment, that is intended for any Christian student, a conservative Christian, who's wondering what to do about climate change. So if you're interested, I could share it. But it sort of walks through, you know, what kind of questioning, without challenging or questioning their worldview, what kind of openings are possible within a worldview, I guess is what I'm saying, is more valuable.
If we're jumping around here, I might jump in here. First of all, to the woman who asked about whether my particular denomination, Methodism, has an eco-justice statement, yes. Does it have a cosmological spirituality statement? No. And I think there's a problem in the disconnect in that. I'm not sure we can have one without the other. Which brings me to the point of the
young man in the back who asked about action. And it is a question that I ask myself every single day, and that what we're doing in the academy and in the church does not result in changed behaviors toward our fellow earth creatures, then it really doesn't mean a darn thing, in my personal non-Methodist opinion. But you are looking up here on this panel at least two former environmental activists and more in the audience I know who have tried for many, many years to convince people of the rightness of these behaviors using the facts. And speaking from one, it's not working. It isn't working. And so while I am very supportive of this great energy now within Christianity, within interfaith efforts through Interfaith Power and Light and the National Religious Partnership, Laurel and I were with 50 activists just last week. There's a groundswell of activity and action, and I'm happy to talk to you afterwards about how to be involved. One thing that experience has taught me is that we cannot act differently until we learn to be different. And there's this consciousness that we've been talking about, that even the change literature is starting to suggest this. Yes, act, but until we change the way people see themselves vis-a-vis the rest of the earth, with the rest of the creation, we are not going to make the systemic change that I think that we all want. So if you are interested in being a part of the movement, I'm happy to give you information on. It's a great question. I'm so very glad you raised it.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
No, you're Canadian. Go ahead.
This time you
it feels very uncomfortable. I'm sorry. Yes, I have to obey. I must comply. The question about inclusive language. You know, I really thought in the late 80s we had finally worked that out and we had accomplished it and we were going to move forward. And it is extremely distressing that not only is it a continuing problem, but I think it's a bigger problem than before. It is tremendously important that we not only move away from non-inclusive language, but I would say deliberately exclusive language. I think some of the time it's deliberately exclusive, just not non-inclusive. The language shapes the way we imagine. It shapes the way we explain ourselves. And in shaping the way we explain ourselves, it eliminates or limits some of the explanation. It creates boundaries and borders that should not be there, that are sinful and are terribly problematic. It is not on the radar for the magisterial Roman Catholic Church. It is not seen as a priority. It is seen as an irritant when it's brought up. So I am not hopeful on that level that change is going to come there, but change generally in the Roman Catholic tradition has not come top down. It has come from bottom up. And so it remains an issue, and it remains an issue that we need to continue to press forward.
Barbara. I want to respond to the question the young man asked about action, because I think this is a really, really important question. And I think right at the intersection of liturgy and civil disobedience is a kind of action that I've seen when I was at Climate, the COP 15 in, or whatever number it was, in Copenhagen, and then again in Cancun. I haven't been to the most recent ones, Durban and stuff, but young people doing sort of skits in front of the delegates that dramatize the urgency of climate, but do it in a whimsical, funny, yet compelling way. I think we've seen it in Occupy Wall Street, for example, when there was an image of the golden calf straight out of the Bible, and then that was paraded down. I mean, I think we need to do a lot more of this kind of ritual action that draws on biblical stories, but helps people visualize where the Bible is meeting the streets now, and how this is an urgent moment, and awakening people's scriptural imaginations really is what it is. So, yes, the Gospel of John, even though there's, of course, problems with the way cosmos is used later, but fortunately in the opening chapter the word becomes flesh, and it's not just human, it's all flesh. But I think we need to do actions that take to the streets the biblical radical message. I think the question, and of course the baptismal question, is for us as Lutherans at least, we have this one category called status confessionis. It was used in Nazi Germany when the state church got taken over by the German Christians. Larry knows his history much better. And then a confessing church had to form that said this issue of Nazi theology is at the level of status confessionis. That is, you cannot be indifferent about this. And certainly in the Barman Declaration, I mean, in that tradition, this issue now is being raised. Is climate change at the level of status confessionis? Do we have to say this is a matter of confession? And of course, there would be, in my own Lutheran church, many who would disagree. Obviously, the people live in the Bakken oil patch, in the, you know, but you know, these are the kinds of questions we have to ask. And I think the more we can raise awareness through imaginative, creative, wonderful, positive, life-giving, provocative actions without having to go the route of status confessionis yet, there's still a lot of space for public action, liturgical action, that takes our liturgies in some really imaginative directions.
Go ahead. I'll go after.
Just a couple of things. For the issue of the image of God, yes, it is grateful. I'm grateful to be a Quaker, but I teach in a Methodist seminary. And I just tell them that they haven't read their Bible if they think that there's only one pronoun for God. And then I tell them that I think it's pretty insulting to God to limit God to just the image of a male. So that usually works and gets something, but you know, they don't want to insult God. I think for Quakers, what leads to action is to recognize what structures of oppression it is that inhibits all of us from recognizing there is that of God in ourselves and each other. And to recognize that is a radical call to action. Otherwise, you aren't really recognizing that. And so I think Paloma, you know, this is a deep, deep concern of Quakers, is the way our social structures have so bound people and disrespected people. And so I think your project is one that so many Quakers would also be practicing, the deep listening to all of the grassroots voices for their articulation of how they understand themselves in this work. Because I think there is much that we have to learn from listening to voices all over the world whose traditions and wisdoms lead them to a similar place, maybe in different language. So I think if we aren't working toward recognizing, I mean, we're used to being a minority religion. We're used to being in the small ones. But if we aren't working toward what is happening on frontline communities, what is happening in breakthrough communities, if we aren't working for justice, then we are not in right relation.
Thank you. Steve.
I wanted to come back to the question about image, image of God and language. We're quite comfortable in this cultural time with God being personal, being able to have a personal relationship with God. We have become much less comfortable, it seems, with the flip side of the theological equation, which is God precedes any sense of any being whatsoever, utterly before and beyond anything we can conceive. And simultaneously, we have to hold those two things, one of which we've dropped. I sometimes think about one of the greatest and most unfortunate beauties in the Western world, which is the painting on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel of God and the spark of life entering Adam. This incredibly beautiful image that's theologically so wrong, so incredibly wrong. I've preached about this. And yet it's so beautiful. So there is part of the paradox, that we're called to live in paradox after paradox after paradox, but there is one of this enormous, unfortunate beauty.
Just quickly, I'll speak to the question about action, how what we spoke about this weekend translates to the pews. I am all for activism. I'm all for prophetic activity a la Occupy Wall Street. But I also want to emphasize the ways in which there are many community organizing-based organizations that work towards long-term change. And what getting on the right path on climate change will take is working towards long-term change. And that involves an engaged citizenry. Now, despite what the Supreme Court tells us, at least last time on their ruling on Citizens United, this is still a democracy. And we're going to have to organize in such a way to work for the sort of long-term change that's going to lead to these sort of substantive developments and changes that we really need to see take place. So I would suggest IAF, PICO, these organizations that are also working on eco-justice issues that are engaged in democratic work that is so powerful and so important today.
Jim. I'm going to be really brief and say this is an opportunity. They don't believe it. This is an opportunity for which the church was born. As a denominational executive, and probably all of you in the room here are aware, there really is only one church in this room that is actually growing. All the rest of us aren't, and that's LDS that's growing. All the rest of us aren't. And we've got many, many, many young people who are asking the same question as that gentleman asked from the back. The opportunity is before us. God is with us. Now is the time.
Actually, the Unitarian Universalists are growing also. I'm a sociologist.
So, there are over 2 billion Christians in the world, so they're growing in other parts of the world.
That's right.
And that's also part of what we are talking about. And I do want to say, as Dennis began, there's Pope's encyclical that is going to be coming out maybe in late spring or something like that. You know, even at the forestry school, a very science-based school, everywhere I talk in different parts of the country, scientists as well are waiting for this That's encyclical. Right. Mm-hmm. And that encyclical, I think, has the power to really ignite these 2 billion Christians around the world. And the question I have for us is, are we going to be able to catch the ball as it comes at us with good ethics, good theology, good action in the pews? But I want to just bring back into our midst, as we make this transition to a living liturgy, is what is a living cosmology? Why did we name this conference in this particular way? And it's the long-term organizations, it's the long-term consciousness change. I'm a big activist from the 60s, and I love, you know, the call to action. But I think we have got to really realize this is, and this is from Brian Swim, okay? I would say this is Brian's message for today. This is going to take not just decades, but hundreds of years. Yep. And that is where the churches yes. can be healing, yes. can be life-giving for the grief that is already out there, but for the hope and transformation that we are all seeking, because we are in a desert. And a living cosmology will be vivifying and renewing for the work that needs to be done on the ground. That is our greatest hope. Let's thank this amazing panel. Thank you so very much.